Eugen Henschi, thank you very much for coming. I'm Thorsten Grote from Alemannia, from Germany. So I hope you can understand me. If not, like, give me a sign. So it's the second Fizzly for me, and I was here 2 years ago, and I had a lot of fun. Was an amazing Fizzly, and I didn't only have fun, but I also talked. And I talked about the Free Android campaign last time. For those who don't know it, it's like ways how to make your Android phone more free, because there's lots of proprietary software that comes with it. So the first step is, for example, to install F-Droid, which is a free app store. But you can also change the entire operating system of many Android phones. So during this presentation, I also talked about ways how people can get involved in this campaign, how they can help making Android more livre. And one way was writing and improving apps yourself. And I told the story, like how in Germany we had an application for public transport, which was very good, like which was written by a nice guy who also wrote other free software programs. Millions of people used this, but this guy didn't make his program software livre. So I was going to talk to him. I met him like in a Berlin hackerspace and had a long conversation with him and tried to find out why not? Like, you don't earn money with this. So it's just a hobby for you. Why is it not software livre? And he had some reasons which I more or less understood, but it turned out he is not going to do it. He is not going to release his application software livre. So then, because he had a library who did all the difficult part of getting the data from the public transport. And this was software livre, at least. So I thought, okay, I have this library from him. You can generally talk to him, so you can cooperate. And so I just wrote my own application. And funnily, last time when I had this presentation here, most questions were actually about this application and not about the Free Android campaign. So I thought, this year, I will not talk about Free Android again, but about public transport. Especially how I liberated the public transport data in Florianopolis. So just to get an idea, this is how the app looked like in the rather beginning. And like some time passed and I had more time to work on it, and Google released the material design specs, so I put a little more work in the app. I changed the name and the logo, so now the app is called Transporter. Looks like this. And this is like the start screen with the navigation drawer. And it's translated completely in Portuguese também. So the first option people start with is the direções, which is really great. Like, it's como chegar. Like, you are here and you want to go to this other place, but you don't maybe know all the bus routes that go there or which train to take. So the application tells you. And the most frequent routes, the favorite trips, you have also here for just one click. The app starts with this, and you can just click there, the trip you use most, and then it tells you, okay, the next bus leaves at this time. And you have these options, for example. Like here, you have two buses, will take you 1 hour, 25 minutes. Then here's one that only takes you 45 minutes, but leaves a little bit later, and you don't need to change the bus. And you can also tap on these connections to get details. So you know exactly what you have to do. You see in the top, you have to go to walk to the next bus station. If you like, you can also see this on the map. If you don't know where the bus stop is, then you take the 360, you get out in the Chilagi terminal, wait there for 20 minutes, and then take this other bus. And you arrive in the center where you wanted to go all along. So that's pretty neat, and that I've been using for years now. Because in Germany and in Berlin, where I'm from, like, there's so much public transport, and it's so good, and everybody uses it. Like, most people don't have a car. And that also is the reason why they don't have, like, a crazy traffic problem there, I think. So another thing the app does is, like, shows you the partidas, the next departures of your, from a station. Like, you can say, I want from this station, see which buses pass there. So, but then it happened. that I actually moved into this lovely city called Florianópolis. Yeah, it's amazing and I like it there a lot, but it has a crazy traffic problem, especially in the summer. And that's everybody takes their own car, sitting alone in their car, and driving everywhere, and the city is just crowded. And you spend 2 hours in the traffic because everybody has their own car. And nobody, there's people taking the buses, it's those people who cannot afford cars. But normally, I think public transport is what should be there for everybody, cheap, affordable, like maybe even free, and accessible for as many people as possible. So for me, as a gringo in Florianópolis, the public transport was not very accessible. Like, it was a little difficult to understand, actually, what was going on. So you have these terminals, like 4 or 5 or 6 over, spread over all the city, which are like the central connection points. And in there, you have like tables where you see these is the buses that pass here, and this is the times they leave, and you even have a TV, which mostly shows advertisement, but sometimes you're lucky and you can actually see the next departures as well. And that's good. Like, with that I can work with. Yeah? But there's many bus stops that just look like this. And even if they don't look like this, even if there is a little house or something, there is not a single bus stop in Florianópolis that has at least the information which bus routes pass there. Like, not even this. You just don't know. You just can stand there the whole day and see which buses pass and make notes, basically, if you want to find out. But there is even bus stops that I've found that they don't even have the sign. You just need to know there is the bus stop. Which is crazy for me, where I'm come from, because there you always have at least a plan on paper seeing which buses pass and when do they pass. So, of course, like, I had this application that I already put so much time in, I wanted to use it in Florianópolis. So let's see how Transporter gets its data and where it works. So this is the map, and all the points are like places where it works. So it's pretty neat because if you travel, chances are that where you travel, Transporter will work. So you don't need to switch to another app, find out which app is good, where will you go. The idea is that it just works everywhere. Like, for me, it's also crazy. Why does every single small public transport company needs its own app? Like, and develop its own app. Like, why not have one or maybe two or three? Like we don't have new web browsers for every website we visit, right? So why do we need different apps? Let's put all the energy in one and make it really good. So you see the concentration of all the dots is in Europe. This is because the guy who wrote the initial library, he reverse engineered the protocols of the public transport companies that had most of the customers in Europe. Yeah, and some other customers, like in Israel or here in San Francisco, they're also customers of this public transport companies, which provide like IT systems, IT solutions. So this was the beginning, but then later, there's the GTFS, the General Transit Field Specification, which also added other cities, and which some guy added support for the library. So let's look at what this GTFS is. So this is a screenshot from the website. It's the General Transit Feed Specification. So it's like a de facto standard nowadays for defining public transport information, essentially. And this was developed by a public transportation company in Portland, which is very free software friendly, also somehow in cooperation with Google. So initially this was called the Google Transit Feed Specification. But now they made it more general, which is nice. Like, they let it go a little bit, let it be a standard, because many public transport companies on the world use this. So this is the Google Maps Transit homepage. If you are a public transport company, you can go there and you can click their Joint Transit Partner Program, and you can upload your data in the GTFS format, so everybody who uses Google Maps can also have the button public transport and gets also the same information that Transporter provides. But I don't like using Google, because Google's business model is providing you with as much information as possible, good information, but so that then you consume the information from Google, they know which information you consume, what your interests are, where you are, what you do, what you like, know as much as possible about you to sell your stuff. And this I don't like. So I prefer do this with Software Livre and Datos Abertos, as free software and open data. So you can see like Brazil is actually like completely colored there, which is not true. Like they don't have support for all Brazil. There is some cities in Brazil, namely Porto Alegre, Rio de Janeiro, Belo Horizonte, São Paulo também, which provide GTFS files and publish them so other people can use them. So in these cities, Transporter works at the moment as well, and Google Maps. So you could, right now, like you go to F-Droid, or if you only have Google Play, you can use that, download Transporter and use it here in Porto Alegre. So I thought, okay, Transporter supports this standard of public transportation information. And many Brazilian public transport companies already publish this. So why does Floripa not do this? And the first thing when you start a new project and you need some information from somebody, like don't reinvent the wheel. It's always good to just ask first. Like I can only recommend this to everybody who does a project. And that's what I did. Like I wrote an email to the Saki of the Consorcio Phoenix, which is the Consorcio of Public Transportation in Florianópolis. And at first also I had to find out who is responsible. Like who can I send an email to? And so the first response was nice and not short, was okay, but essentially they didn't understand what the GTFS actually is. They say, this will be an investment and we need to pay Google for this. But don't worry about this because we will make our own system, the SAO and the CCO, and it'll be good and we make a pilot project and maybe next year we'll be ready. Right? But that's not what I wanted. I wanted just them to publish the information that they have, like many other cities in Brazil do. And I argued a little bit more with them. There were other emails, but essentially I came to the same conclusion, like these people are not going to publish it. So I thought, okay, maybe I can do something myself here. So I was looking at how this GTFS specification actually looks like what do I need to make a GTFS file? And this is like the rough overview. This is all the files. It's just text files. It's very simple. It's very nice and it's well specified. So it's just text files you need to put in a zip file. Text files in a zip file. Very easy. So these are all the required ones. There's more optional ones, but these are the interesting ones. So the first one, agency TXT. Very simple. It's just information about the public transportation company which provides the service from the file. Yeah, just their website and which time zone they are in, and this is easy to get. So let's skip the stops and look at the routes. So a bus route is like you saw before, a bus 300, like goes from there to there. And on the homepage of Consorcio Phoenix, at least this information is available. You can search there for the numbers, but you can also get an overview like of all the bus routes they have. Okay, so check. This information I can get somehow. It's there. So next is trips. So because on one bus route, the bus makes many trips. Yeah, there is one, like for example, here from the homepage, there's one at 5:50 in the morning, then there's another one at 6:25. This is all the trips. Okay, this information is there on the homepage, I can get. Next one, now is the stops. This is where it gets a little more complicated. Because as you've seen here on the slide, they do have times when the bus leaves the terminal. It's all they have. They have an itinerario, but it's just street names, basically. So, okay, there is, like, in this Rua, there is a Ponto Final, but where is it? Where is it? Where are all the bus stops? they don't have to, I don't even know if they know it themselves, actually, to this day. So, looking a little deeper in the stop.txt file, you see there is what I even need is I need the latitude and longitude of the stop. And I need a name. And all those three things don't exist. Some bus stops in Florianopolis have the name of the street and a number. Like there is Rua Laureninaris 35. Okay, so this is where it gets really difficult. But there was a little bit of hope when I saw that they have this on their homepage. So somehow, they have more than just the streets that bus passes. They have quite a precise route of the bus. And they render it on top of Google Maps, which has like funny things that here, the Universidad Federal Santa Catarina is not UFSCI, but CEUA, whatever that is. And there's some English labels as well sometimes. And it's, I think, actually illegal what they do. Yeah, because they cannot just use Google Maps for this. This is, has a copyright. It's not free. So, but they have this information. That they weren't willing to give it. But even here, you just have the start and the end position. You don't know where the bus stops are still. Because what if you want to take the bus here in the middle? Where is the stop where you can get this bus? So there was nothing I could do here with the official information that they put out. So I was looking elsewhere, and the first natural choice for me was OpenStreetMap. Who does not know what OpenStreetMap is? Okay. Who knows what is OpenStreetMap? Okay. So OpenStreetMap is basically like Wikipedia, but for maps. Yeah, turns out you don't need Google Maps at all, because there is OpenStreetMaps, and it's created by volunteers since many years. So whenever you are somewhere, you can use OpenStreetMap and see information that is missing and just put it there. And I've been active in this community also since a long time, and put more information in the map whenever it was missing. And it turned out there was one guy, but also others, only a handful of people in Florianopolis that added information about public transport to OpenStreetMap. So when you go on the OpenStreetMap website, you have here in the top, you can almost not see this, there is an edit button. Yeah, like in Wikipedia, you go to an article, and if you want, you can edit the article. So you can edit the map. And this is the in-browser editor. So if you, for example, pass the street, check your smartphone with OpenStreetMap, oh, this bus stop is not in the map, so I just put it. And here, even in the browser, it's very easy. Or in your neighborhood, where's the bakery? Information like this. And in many areas of the world, and I think even here in Brazil, OpenStreetMap has more information and it's more detailed than Google Maps. Like where it's especially strong is like when you have like little footpaths where the Google car cannot go into. Like Trilias, like the Google car doesn't go there and maps those. But OpenStreetMap has them. And this is another editor, it's called JOSM. It's a Java editor, which is a little more complicated, but it's more powerful for power users. Because how OpenStreetMap works is a very simple principle. You just have essentially two types of data. You have nodes and you have Waze, which is a connection between two nodes. So if you put a bus stop, you just put one node in the map and you tag it. You give it tags. You can see there it has a name tag with Rua Diputado Antonio Edoviera, blah, blah, blah. And then it has a tag shelter. Has it shelter? Yes or no. And the tag highway bus stop shows everybody that this is a bus stop. And you can have here, you have this is a node with the tag letterbox. And this is many nodes which have one way which connect them all, and this is a street. This is then tag highway residential, for example. It's a simple principle, and the web editor even helps you with this. It tells you, okay, you search for bus, and then it offers you bus stop, and you just click, okay, this is bus stop. And the other thing it has is relations. So you can have nodes and ways, and you can put them in a relation. So this relation says all these objects belong somehow together. And for a bus route, you have a relation which includes all the roads that the bus takes and the stops. And the guy that did most of the work in Germany, finally turns out he was also German. So I wrote also to all the people and asked them, okay, yeah, I'm thinking about doing this project. Like, can you help me a little bit? And what do you think? What is the state of the information in OpenStreetMap? Is it complete enough? Like, can I do this? Like, I was checking, is it possible, like, to do it? And the German guy told me, like, when he arrived in Florianopolis, he drove around with all the buses and mapped all the stops just to get to know the city, get to know the bus, and to contribute to OpenStreetMap. So that was very nice, because then I could use his work to build my project on top of that. But to this day, there is not everything in OpenStreetMap. Like, there's many bus routes that are still missing, but the main things that you need are there. So I need to find out, how do I get the data out of OpenStreetMap? And there is some nice APIs for that. There is a simple API where you just say, give me the node with this number, give me the way with this number, or give me the relation with this number. But this doesn't really work for me, because I don't know which numbers I need to ask for. So there is another API called Overpass, where you can actually make queries. So here in the top, can you see this even from back there? Maybe not. So this is a query, and there's a query language, and this is an XML, because I found it easier to understand than the other query language they offer. And I just say, okay, this is a query for a relation. So I want all the relations that has the key value pair route and bus. So give me all the bus routes. And I don't want everything on the whole planet. So that's why I put a bounding box, which is just the coordinates of a rectangle in the map. So just give me the stuff that is in here. And then this is like, give me also all the items which are part of this relation. And this you can do in the web browser. It's very nice to experiment with stuff. You can write and change this, and then you click on run in the top left, and then you get the result on the right side in the map. And this is like basically all the public transport objects which are in Florianopolis in OpenStreetMap, which is a lot. Like, it's basically all covered. And on the top right, you see there's a map, which is one you would use to look at, but there's also a data button. And there is what the API actually returns for you. It's like either JSON, XML, or some other things. So it's nice. It's what you want. It's machine-readable data about the public transport objects. And this exists also in many other cities. Like, there's certain standards that people who use OpenStreetMap follow. So it's available maybe also in your city. So, okay, problem one solved. We have sufficient data of sufficient quality in OpenStreetMap, and there is APIs to get it out. So next was like, how do I actually write this GTFS? Like, I didn't want to do this manually. So it's also another thing that I can recommend you: reuse stuff that is already there. Like, especially when you do a project like this, I thought in the beginning, this is going to be quick. I do this over the weekend. Wasn't quick. But still, like, you want to be as quick as possible, so reuse whatever you can. So I found on GitHub there is a Python library for reading, validating, and writing transit schedule information in the GTFS format. So awesome. This is exactly what I need. I can even validate my feed with this and make sure it's properly working, properly specified. And this is actually released by Google. So it's the ones that are working most with this stuff. So it has to be good. So I thought, okay, let's use this. And I like Python for quick prototyping stuff. It's awesome. So I looked for the OpenStreetMap APIs, and also there were Python APIs, Python libraries already, which were doing the job. So I could just easily plug everything together. Still one problem. The information from the Consortium Phoenix homepage that they have there, I don't like do website scraping, right? Because if they change their website, I always need to change my script. And there actually were some people in Florianopolis which did their own public transport apps, and how they get their data is website scraping. Yeah, so website scraping means you have a script that downloads the websites and looks for certain markers which they set before and then says, okay, after this table tag, here is the color green, so that means here must be the number of the bus route. And here in this other table, there in the, is maybe the time. Yeah, and this is not really machine readable, like I would say. It works, but it's messy. So I didn't want to do this. So I looked around and found the app of the Consortium Phoenix, which I don't actually like so much. But what they actually do is it's just a better version of the website. It doesn't have any more information than the website. It doesn't do routing. And you need to know, it doesn't tell you where is the bus stops either. So one more indication that they maybe even don't know themselves. They just tell you this is the line, it starts in the terminal at this time. Okay, this is not what I want. And I wanted to use my own app and it has much more features. So, no, but how is this app getting its data? They will not pass their own website. So I fired up Wireshark. Got in between the communication of the app with whatever communication it does and looked what is it doing. And it sent an unencrypted HTTP request to the server of the Consortium Phoenix and was downloading a gigantic JSON file. So jackpot, there's all the data in JSON format. So that made my life a lot easier, even though it was a strangely formatted JSON file, but I could figure that out. So I had everything I need, so I could just put everything together, and I wrote a Python script, a prototype, which I called now OSM to GTFS. Because the main thing what it does is pulling all the information down from OpenStreetMap and putting it together with the schedule information that which I get from the JSON of the Consortium Phoenix. So that was really nice and took me some time to get it working. Like there were lots of tricky details, but eventually this thing was generating a GTFS file, and the transit feed library from Google, like it had just transit feed add route, so just add route with these parameters, add trip with this parameter. So very easy. In the end, you just say transit feed write GTFS file. There's your GTFS file. So nice and simple. But when I hit this file, then you just have a zip file with text files. Like you still don't have an application that can actually use this. Because how Transporter works is it connects to a web service which is doing all the magic in the background. And there is a French company called Kizio Digital who developed this awesome web service is called Navicia or Navitao, or I don't know how they like to pronounce it. But it's software livre, and you can host this yourself, but they also provide a service. And this is what Transporter uses at the moment to provide the support for Porto Alegre, Rio de Janeiro, Sao Paulo, and Belo Horizonte. So basically, I look whenever there is a new transport agency publishes their file, and then I tell those guys, could you please add this? There's a new file, please add it. And they are usually quite quick, add it, and then it just works in Transporter without even needing me to release a new update. So that's awesome. But in this case, like I asked them, would you guys be open if I have like a self-generated GTFS file that you would also use for yourself? And they said, yeah, if it's good and working, we could do this. Awesome. So that's good. But then I thought, like, this is a prototype. Like, I'm still playing with this. I need to test this. And maybe sometimes, like, maybe I break it. Maybe I need to update it quickly. Or the information changes, I need to update. And maybe they, because I'm not their customer, and they're not my employees. So sometimes they take some time to do stuff. It's better maybe if I have this under my own control. So I was looking into running the software myself on my own server. So this is basically the architecture of the Navicia software. So it's comprised of several components. And you in the bottom, like you need to start looking. In the bottom, there is on the right side the GTFS data, which you put inside. Then it gets processed by a program which is called GTFS to add. And add is like one of their programs which uses a PostgreSQL database to put all this information in and to later process it. And then they themselves use data from OpenStreetMap for the region that they cover to get points of interest, to get the street names. Because when you just, for example, put the GPS position, I'm here and I want to go there, they can tell you, okay, there is this street you are in and you want to go there. Or I'm searching, like auto-completion, I'm searching, I want to go to, what is here, like the aqueduct? I want to go to the aqueduct. So it's in OpenStreetMap, it's a point of interest. So it can auto-complete, it has geo-coordinates, so it can give you a route to the aqueduct. So that's why they use OpenStreetMap themselves. They all put it in their database, and then they have an add to NAV, and NAV is some sort of format they use. I don't know if it's proprietary or not, but in the end, you get a file. And this has all the information you need. So all this part, I'm running in a virtual machine on my local computer. Like a virtual machine is like a virtual computer. So I don't have to have all this PostgreSQL stuff on my desktop computer running all the time. But then I have this file, and I push it up to my server. And on my server, I have Kraken and Jomong and here running, which communicate with the ZMQ, RabbitMQ socket stuff. And all this, they have Debian packages as well. So my server runs Debian. I can just add get install their software and also update it. So it's a Kraken. It's like a C++ daemon which runs all the time and gets like the queries from the Python program above, which is connected to the Apache web server, gets the requests over the API, and then Kraken makes the routing computation. The routing algorithm, because it has to find out, like, okay, there's this route, and he wants to go there, so which buses can he take? Yeah, there's some computations that is necessary there. And then I put all this together, let it run, I make sure the API works and is up and running, and then I tried it with my own API request or my own NAV file, which I generated. And then, of course, it didn't work. And there was various problems I had to sort out, and like it's a big system administration job also to get all this running. And but the biggest problem was actually this that I haven't talked about yet. This is a GTFS specification again, and there is also stop times. So what the specification says is, for all your stops that you have in a trip, you need per trip to say, in this stop, the public transportation, like the train or the bus, the vehicle needs to be there at this time, and there at this time, and there at this time. Okay. Thankfully, the specification says it's enough. You don't have to give like all the time points. It's enough if you give the first and the last. So this is what I did, and this is why my file validated and my file worked. But turned out the Navicia software does not support this. They want timestamps for everything. So first I tell you how I got the end time. So the end time I got because this is also from their homepage, because they have tempo di percorso. So they for approximately 46 minutes it takes the bus to do the whole circle or the one route. And so I saw when it starts here at 6, I know at 6:46, it's approximately at the final point. So I had start and end point. But I didn't have all the other points. So after being like, no, it doesn't work, and they don't do this, so I opened a GitHub issue for the software and said, okay, like this doesn't work. And today, it's still not solved, so it's still open. So good that I found another solution in the meantime. The other solution is, the transit feed library by Google has actually a simple method call, which I can call and say, generate all these intermediate time points, like approximate them. Like you know the distance, roughly, the points from each other, and you know the total time it takes, so just like approximate the times in between. So after I implemented that, I finally got it working, so when I made my first query, something like this came out. And I say, yay, now I actually can see the directions. And clicking on the details, I could see, okay, where to get out when and stuff. So I was like, ah, oh, okay, this works, awesome, I can use this. Now I can get around by bus in Florianopolis. But because it was fun, like doing this was fun. So I thought when I was done, what can I do next? There is some optional files in the GTFS specification, and one of them is the shapes. Like shapes is like how to draw a line on the map that represents the route the bus takes. So Transporter supports like many networks like you've seen, and some of them don't have these shapes information. And then it looks like this. Like this is in Berlin, and there's two bus stops, and when there is no shape information, the only thing we can do is we can just draw a direct line between the stops. But this is not where the bus actually goes. Like it goes right through the river, and the bus doesn't do this. So the bus goes like here in the streets. So I wanted to improve this, and thankfully all this information is in OpenStreetMap because they have these relations which have all the roads. But this was also a little tricky because the roads sometimes, like they like, have like a direction, the ways, and they can be like switched, and I needed all the points in the good order, so I needed to check, okay, which is the direction, which point is matches the start point of the last way, and wrote some algorithm to always connect all the ways well. But then I let the script run, and I got tons of errors because there were still problems like those. Like, this is a bus route, like in red, on the painted on the road, but in front of the terminal, in the middle, it's just missing. It's not there. And sometimes, for example, like somebody puts in a new street that goes from the main street, so they split the way in OpenStreetMap and make it go like this, but then this other part, which is like not connected anymore, so this happened a lot, and actually, so my script was doing quality assurance for OpenStreetMap. So, because it automatically, stupidly, just went through the algorithm of getting this data, it found a lot of problems. So I always, when I found a problem, I went to OpenStreetMap, had some debugging information, okay, which way is this, where is the problem, then opened the editor and fixed all the things until my script ran through and generated the information. So when you press on the map button in Transporter, it looks now like this. So you can see there is lots of bus stops actually. So all these little things here is a bus stop. And here in the middle, you change the bus, you start there, and here's your final destination. So because the guys from OpenStreetMap are like so perfectionists and do everything really nicely, when you zoom into this, you even see this. Like because the bus takes like this thing on the highway and goes around one time, you even see this in the drawing. So I was pretty like, wow, that's great. So you work with something, you work with your code, and you don't see anything, but in the final moment, you press the button, and suddenly, wow. So that made me pretty happy. And today, like, there is still not everything in my app, but if you go to OpenStreetMap, and you add more bus stops, or you add a new bus route, you use it in Florianopolis, but this one bus route you always need is not inside. What you can do is you just go to OpenStreetMap, you put the bus route inside, and then next time I run my script, it automatically gets picked up and edited the information without me needing to do anything, which is also pretty nice. So I hope also that it motivates more people to contribute information to OpenStreetMap. Something else I haven't actually in my slides, I don't know why, I probably forgot, is that I went to the Prefettura. Like I wrote an email to the Prefettura and asked, okay, do you have this information about the bus stops, like where they are? And the Prefettura then said, Yes, you can come and make an appointment and get them. So, wow, awesome. But then, like, they didn't answer for some time, and it was difficult. And then one day I was there, but the guy didn't show up, and I was waiting and waiting, and then eventually, like, somebody said, yeah, the guy arrived already 10 minutes ago. So they sent me to him, and he was very nice and very friendly, and I gave him a USB key. He put it in their computer and just downloaded tons and tons of Excel files. Like, they also, like, how they organize their data is also crazy, but but they have, like, so the mystery got solved. I don't know if the consortium has it, but at least the prefettura has information about all the bus stops. Like, they have them sorted, like, they have one folder per street, and then they have one file inside this folder with the bus stops only for this street. So I gave this to the German guy who was contributing so much to OpenStreetMap, and he isn't finished yet, but he started to put all this information into one big spreadsheet. Like, why do you have thousands of small spreadsheets? So we have now one big spreadsheet, but now this information needs to be imported into OpenStreetMap so we can add all the missing stops. And when we are done with this, we really have all the stops, all the bus stops. But what we still don't have is which line passes on the stops. So this is something we cannot do automatically at the moment, so we have to go manually through this. But usually in Florianopolis, except some small exceptions, then the bus passes the stop, it also stops. So you can just see the bus route goes here, and here's all the stops. This bus stop is not yet part of the route relation, so you just add it. It's very simple, and when you're bored and when you need to relax, this is the perfect stuff to do. It's like knitting or something. So the take-home message, like, even if you want to do some other project, like, if you go home today and you, what did I learn in this presentation? Like, I hope there's at least these 3 points you take home with you. So the first one is ask. Yeah, maybe the information is already there that you need or what you want to do. Like, I didn't want to write an application that does public transport. Like, I was in this free Android campaign, and I needed an application for myself, and I'm only using Software Livre on my phone. So there was this other application, but I didn't use it because, well, if I just use non-free software, like, who does the free software, right? So it makes you lazy. Like, why should you make effort into making stuff free if you can just use the non-free stuff? So I wasn't doing this. So I was, okay, consequent here, not using this great program that's already there. I'm doing it myself because nobody else does. And the guy who already has it doesn't make it free. Okay, but I asked. In my case, it didn't work, but sometimes it helps. Like, we had many examples in the campaign where people asked people why the apps are not free, and then they made it free. Yeah, because sometimes they're just too lazy to put the source code out there. So asking is always good. The second point, reuse. Reuse as much stuff as possible. Don't reinvent the wheel. There's also other people who solve problems. You don't need to solve the same problems again. Yeah, and by using their stuff, you maybe find problems with their stuff. You can contribute back to them. Like with the Navizia, I also found some problems. They had time zone issues for the Southern Hemisphere because nobody was using their stuff in the Southern Hemisphere. Their time zones didn't work. Suddenly, all my times were 1 hour off. So I reported this to them. They fixed the problem, made their software better. So this is also good when you reuse things. Second point is persist. Because usually whatever you do, it's not so easy like you think in the beginning. So just stop when you're done. As simple as that. Don't give up. Like, continue doing things. So if you want to download Transporter, like, I have a homepage with links to Google Play and to Google Play and to the F-Droid store. So you can do this right now. And if you want to do what I did for your own region, like, if asking doesn't work and you want to replicate what I did, and add your software to GTFS. GTFS also does not only work with Navizia and Transporter, but there's many other software that works with GTFS. So it's good to have this data available. So the script is here in the repository on GitHub. And if you think about doing something like that, it doesn't need to be, It doesn't need to be all programming and stuff. It can also be much simpler sometimes. Tomorrow, there is a workshop. Same time in the Luis Osorio Waldorf space out there in the middle, and I'll be there at 12. And when you like, just drop by, and we can talk with each other, like how we can do something in your city if you're interested in that. So I hope to see some of you at least there. And that is now the end of my presentation. Muito obrigado for listening so attentively and nodding and smiling at me. I appreciate it. Thank you very much. E agora a gente tem tempo para perguntas. A gente tem 3 minutos. Cinco. So we have already, like while you guys are still thinking, we have already 3. How long you took to make your entire project? Well, I did not work, like of course, every day and not full time. This is a hobby project on the side, so it's hard to tell, but it was, well, I think 2 months maybe to have something running, and then like a little more. And it's still not finishing, no? Because the data changes, I need to update things, I need to automate more things so I can roll out updates quicker. So it's an ongoing thing, but I would say 2 months, more or less. How many developers or contributors the project has? So there's various projects. There is the Navicia who does the routing and the web service to query all the data. There's Transporter, there's OpenStreetMap, and so just Transporter has, I think, on GitHub says it's like 20 or so people, but there's just people that contribute from time to time. Like most of the work is just me, I do myself. And the Florianopolis stuff, like it was also just me and this other German guy helping me a little bit with the OpenStreetMap stuff. So essentially me with help of many other people that already for years built other projects I could build on top on, like even the Google developers who made this Python library. So if you count all those, it's like thousands of people. How many developers, how long? How does it all work with updated info, like current departing time and current ETA? How to send this over? So the general transit feed specification, the GTFS has a real-time protocol as well. But Transporter at the moment does not support it. Like it has real-time information for the other services it uses to get the data. So in Berlin, I see, my train will be 10 minutes delayed, so I can take it easy. Yeah, that's nice. And I'm used to this, and I would like to have it. And the Consortio Phoenix is building something with real-time. But I don't expect this to be ready anytime soon, and I don't expect them to use open standards to publish this information. But if they do, that would be awesome, and I would work on getting it into Transporter. So what I can do is only update the static information, and all the times there is approximate. When the bus leaves the terminal, this is more or less always correct, but on the middle of the way, if there's a big traffic jam, the bus will be late and the app will not tell you. So it's, but Google also doesn't have, actually Google does not work in Florianopolis at all. Like this is only my app that does. Because of course I don't give my GTFS file to Google, but somebody else could. How long? Which problems you're facing to get public transport data from government? Well, I talked a little bit about this already. One problem is they don't even have all the data themselves. It's not always the government who has the data. Sometimes it's this private companies who have it and who are not keen on getting it out. For me, the personal problem is I don't speak Portuguese so well. So it's a little difficult if I talk to government officials, like this guy from the Prefetura. So I had my wife was actually there helping me with the communication. But like I appreciate that at least the other cities, like Rio, São Paulo, Porto Alegre, Belo Horizonte, that they proactively publish this data. So there is not even a problem. I didn't even need to ask. It was just there. It just showed up. And I hope that more government agencies in Brazil do this. Here in Porto Alegre, it's only the buses that are public, not this train which goes to Novo Hamburgo, São Leopoldo. like maybe some of you would like to ask whoever runs these trains about their schedule information and if they don't have the file to publish. Because then we could just easily add it to Transporter and you would have the whole coverage in Porto Alegre as well. Because the train is nice. Is anyone using Lei de Acesso, a informação? That's a good idea. Like, I don't know so much about the Brazilian leis and the laws here, like, and how it works. Like, I'm a gringo. Like, I rely on people like you to do this thing. Yeah, so that's why I'm telling you about it. It's all possible. And yeah, if you have a Lei de Acesso, a informação, yeah, please use it. Get this data, please. Like, the more, the better. Like, my dream is that Transporter one day works in the whole world. Wherever you go, you can use the local public transport with one application. That would be awesome. Everywhere. Is Lei de Acesso a Informação useful? I think it's useful. Like, at least in other parts of the world it is. I don't know how it works here. We don't have any more time. And but I'm done through all the questions. And there is the workshop tomorrow. And you can also come talk to me after the presentation right now. Otherwise, thanks again, and see you around at Fesli.